So, Kim, what's on your radar?
Well, a shocking new report was released last week detailing the devastating impacts of school closures on kids. The McKinsey and Company study, which, by the way, is criticized as being too optimistic because they actually failed to study kids who remained entirely online, reports that kids are now severely behind in academics, are depressed, and are lacking key social and communication skills. Anxiety is up. School dropout rates are rising, and the economic impacts of the loss of education will extend well into adulthood. In fact, they predict the average student will now earn at least 11% less throughout their lifetime. What's most alarming is the disparity in the impacts. It would be one thing if all of the children were equally behind together, but that's not what's happened. The study showed 30% of children, mostly in white, wealthy areas, received high quality or decent quality distance education. 50% of the country, mostly middle class, received low quality online education. And the worst outcome was the 20% of children, mostly in poor communities, who never even logged on. Now, most kids are now a half a year to, in some cases, an entire year behind in reading and math. Some kids learned a little, some didn't learn anything. Others actually lost skills that they had once already learned. Now, why is this? Well, kids in wealthier communities had access to the internet, one device per child, and parents who worked from home. Kids in poor communities were often left without reliable internet access, maybe one device to share amongst their siblings, and essential worker parents who had to be away while their kids struggled to learn alone. So while it was tough for white-collar workers to manage Zoom calls and keep their kids in front of a computer in the next room, imagine struggling poor single moms who were trying to deliver Uber Eats while their kids attempted to learn on an iPhone in the back seat. And this doesn't even take into account the privileged children like those of Gavin Newsom, who were shuffled off to private school for in-person learning while public schools remained shuttered throughout the state. His children and others like his now have an advantage over other kids when it comes time to compete in the world economy. Now, with these sorts of education gaps, the rich will stay rich while the poor get poorer. And a loss of learning wasn't the only devastating impact. The report shows one in three teen girls and one in five teen boys have experienced new or worsening anxiety. Around half of the parents say they have noticed a new or worsening mental condition for their teens since the start of the pandemic. And a different study found that 92% of kids ages 6 to 11 have lost at least one specific language ability. Though the impacts of each for each individual child are startling and will possibly leave them lagging throughout their lives, the consequences for us as a society are also cause for concern. Not only will the average student earn less, but the study estimates the entire nation will also suffer an annual GDP loss of up to $188 billion per year once these kids hit the workforce. Since money and poverty are often directly related to property crime and domestic violence, we can anticipate an increase in both. And with reports of rising rates of anxiety and depression, we can also anticipate an increase in alcohol and drug abuse as these teens hit adulthood. And we're already seeing these trends now with teens who weren't in school. The Chicago Police Department noticed a 180% increase in carjackings in January of 2021 when compared to the same month in years previously. When they looked at who was committing these crimes, well, it was mostly youth between the ages of 15 and 20 years old. New York and Minneapolis also report the same trends of an increase in grand larceny and carjackings up 400 to 500%, committed mostly by teens and young adults. Numerous studies also show a link between a lack of education, high school diploma, and incarceration of juvenile delinquents. 75% are kids who are chronically truant, showing a link between being disconnected from adults and crime. With many kids having very little in-person contact with adults throughout the last school year, it's no wonder teen crime is soaring. Now, we can't undo the fact an entire generation is now severely set back from a year of unfinished learning, and thinking these kids can just catch up and will be all will be well is completely unrealistic. Young kids missed out on key skills during valuable periods of their early development, and older kids will reach adulthood without being under the wings of their parents and schools to make up for that lost year. So it's important that we as a society recognize these impacts and create a long-term plan to address the side effects that are going to stem from this hugely disruptive year. We are staring at a long-term, very real crisis when these kids grow into adulthood and become the backbone of our communities and economy. We now have an entire generation of people who lack proficiency, are more anxious and depressed, more prone to crime, poverty, drug and alcohol abuse, and lack the social skills to manage in the workplace. When the time comes, expecting this generation to just pull themselves up by their bootstraps won't cut it. We need to first, do everything at all costs to keep schools open and kids in classrooms. And secondly, we need to be collectively aware of the ramifications we're going to be dealing with in the coming decades. So this is my big concern, is that, you know, there is sort of this mentality that, you know, just pull yourself up by your bootstraps. You'll be fine. Do what you can. And unfortunately, you know, these kids have been set back quite a bit. I mean, this 1 year, to some people might think, oh, they could just catch up, but it's going to be really, really difficult for them to do. I'm just worried that when the time comes, the nation won't rally around these kids. And because it's going to be so far away from now, it's going to be maybe a decade from now that we really start seeing these ramifications.
Well, the time is really now, you know, to start, you know, doubling down on investment in these kids, because, you know, not only did they spend the last year and a half, you know, not growing intellectually and not learning, but like you said, a lot of kids actually went backwards and forgot things, unlearned things that they knew in March of 2020 when everything was shut down. And so I do think it really is incumbent on, you know, state and federal lawmakers to, as they're opening up this, you know, $6 trillion piggy bank, to make sure that they're investing as much as they possibly can, realistically, into education to try to close as much of this gap as possible.
Well, and we still haven't solved the root of the problem. There is no commitment nationally that all schools are going to reopen this coming school year. So I completely agree. I was a proponent early into the pandemic. Kids are less likely to get seriously ill from COVID. We should be reopening schools, getting kids back in in-person education, and taking the safe mitigation tactics we need to ensure that they're healthy and safe. But we're still looking at a school year where many kids will not return to in-person education. So the problem is now, but down the road, you're absolutely right, Kim and Ryan, we are going to have to address this in some way.
Yeah. Well, Ryan, we're looking forward to your radar next.